the history of the project does start with Ted Happold coming to Bath in, I think, the sort of mid-late 70s. And lots of other people who now tutor and help out with the project remember their time doing it too. But I think what's really nice about having the Happold Foundation's kind of official involvement now and sponsorship of it really kind of brings home how, you know, actually the project is a really nice basis for the real world and how things really work in practice and how that collaboration between the disciplines works.
I'll be like, oh, what would Pierre say about my environmental strategy? Oh, he would not agree. Let me change that.
A lot of back and forth, a lot of discussion, a lot of argument. Yeah.
But to kind of work out a way of communicating ideas, not just sitting around one piece of paper and drawing to explain things.
We had to try and harness our inner Sam and Caroline and think about the servicing and the environmental strategies and the structure as we're doing it.
I think it's sort of like a skill to learn, to discuss with your team and sort of come to an agreement together.
The power of drawing was definitely something we realised was super important, but clarity of drawing and diagrams.
When we were thinking about what the project should be in terms of a brief, taking into account the foundation's ideals and kind of aspirations, we were really cognizant of the UN Sustainability Development Goals. We thought, well, why don't we do a building for the UN as a kind of imaginary client, and then in a way all those things are implicit in that. And then that kind of grew into this idea of a library for the world on the site adjacent to the iconic UN Secretariat Tower.
Our scheme was focusing a lot on trying to create a third place for the city, a place where people from different cultures could interact and meet in an extension of their living room sort of idea.
We had this sort of story going throughout our building about like past, present, future. And we wanted to try and incorporate that into the structural story as well. So the concrete is more of like a well-established technology, and then timber is more of a look to the future of maybe how high-rise buildings could develop.
I think we started with discussions talking about the disparity within the UN. And we're trying to think of something positive that all cultures could relate to, and that is in every culture, so sort of as a universal trait everything has. So I think that's where the idea of music came from.
Our scheme aimed to replace the Robert Moses playground, which already existed on the site, and we aimed to kind of bring the playground through the whole building, creating different terrace spaces that connect to the libraries.
We started off with the structure from the beginning, so we knew that we wanted sort of a concrete core and then a timber frame on the outside. We wanted to house the archive within the core, which is sort of protected by the inhabited spaces on the outside.
So we decided to do a tower that included people through food, so that was our whole scheme. And it's a very colourful scheme because we decided that we wanted to integrate all the colours of food and fusion, but also try and attract all age groups.
Given the working conditions that they had and how the teams developed in those really early initial weeks, I'm really impressed with the outcome. So we spend a lot of time as tutors ensuring that we can get all the students together in a Zoom call or a Teams call and sort of rebuild that team feeling.
Overall, the whole building creates a warm and humane environment with a comfortable atmosphere through the exposure of timber.
We're taking a very global concept that's really accessible to everybody, and we're making a structure that serves the city both as a library but also as a community space. So works a lot on the UN Sustainable Development Goals of zero hunger and education.
The harmony between architectural, structural and environmental elements in the scheme stemmed from a collaborative design process.
We've been able to create a design that balances both structural and architectural intent to become a building which puts the community within its core. A building that we're all very proud to have been a part of.
The longevity of the project, we first began by reimagining what the library of the future would look like.
Our design process was upheld by proactive communication, complementary skills, and common work ethic, resulting in fulfilling interdisciplinary teamwork and ultimately an enjoyable project experience.
I had one question on durability.
The question in my head really is efficiency of the 2 meter deep truss.
I didn't quite understand what the environmental strategy is.
And I think there's just something genius about, you just got to look at it, it's a jewel.
I think we've learned so much from this project. I mean, particularly, you know, having the prestigious client, using the UN SDGs, that those are going to roll forward in future years as drivers in all of our projects?
In first place, for the first TED Prize, after 45 years, is Team 22.
The team described how the architects would use some architectural language and then the engineers would have some engineering language, and there was a bit of a jargon gap sometimes, and how you'd kind of work together to describe to one another what you meant and try to get into each other's worlds. And that's what this project is all about. I think listening today has just been absolutely amazing, and I think Ted Happold would be very, very proud if he was here, kind of hearing you all present your amazing projects.